The dominant teams in college football all have a trademark, a signature position at which year in and year out, their players define excellence and set the standard by which all others are measured. While Florida State has had its share of greats at every position on the football field, no team has had a higher standard of excellence in the defensive secondary than the Seminoles. Defensive backs must possess a combination of skills, including speed, strength, awareness, instinct, and attitude. When the stage is set, those skills must be honed to near perfection. As a whole, the secondary must function as a cohesive unit. Their primary goal is simple: shut down the opponent's passing game. Not for one moment can a defensive back doubt where his teammates in the secondary might be, for it is a split second of doubt that can provide an opponent the opportunity for the big play. Many Seminoles have played the position and played it well. Who can forget the punishing play of safeties Lee Nelson and Keith Jones, Martin Mayhew's role in the Seminoles' emergence as a national power, or Devin Bush's interception that sealed the fate of Miami during the Seminoles' national championship season of 1993. But what separates the legendary players from the good ones has been their flair for the dramatic and their participation in some of Florida State's most memorable moments on the gridiron. From the early years of two-way players like Bud Whitehead and Lee Corso, to the tough physical play of JT Thomas, from Leroy Butler and the punt Ruski, to the flamboyant and spectacular play of Thorpe Award recipients Terrell Buckley and Deion Sanders, FSU's men in the secondary have put on a show that has dazzled college football. Florida State University and Universal Sports America are proud to present the second in a series of Garnet and Gold Seminoles. Join us as we take a look at Florida State's greatest defensive backs. The first of Florida State's great defensive backs isn't always remembered for his outstanding play on the defensive side of the football. What most people remember Lee Corso for was his ability as a halfback. After all, it was a big deal to football fans in the Sunshine State when one of the most heavily recruited players of the day chose Florida State, a program that was still in relative infancy. But by the time Lee Corso had graduated, he was the career leader in interceptions at FSU with 14, a mark that would stand for almost a quarter of a century.
What brought me to Florida State University at that time was the fact that I wanted to be a part of building something. I saw in Coach Tom Nugent a man who I thought had a lot of integrity and character, and I think he had a plan on how he was going to take Florida State to the next level. And I wanted to be a part of that particular era of building something, not going to one of these schools that were talking to me because I would be just another number. There, I felt if I came here, I felt that I could make a contribution to Florida State University and make it a better place for me being here.
During those early years, Coach Tom Nugent didn't possess the depth that other more developed football programs did. Many of his players were forced to play Iron Man football, lining up on both sides of the ball. Following Lee Corso, another two-way player arrived in Tallahassee to lead the Seminole secondary. Bud Whitehead, from nearby Marianna, could best be described as a jack of all trades. A versatile athlete, Bud also played basketball for FSU, becoming the first in a distinguished line of two sports stars who played in the Seminole secondary. But aside from being a defensive back, Bud saw action as a halfback, punter, and kickoff and punt return specialist.
I guess, you know, when you're 19, 20, 21, you don't think too much about being tired. And I don't recall being exhausted, even though, as you said, I did happen to do several jobs for the team as a running back and a punter and return punts and kickoffs and as a defensive back. But I don't recall being exhausted and worn out. It was just, I think a lot of teams probably had several guys who did the same thing I did. They're on the field a lot. It, you know, not the platoon type football you see today. In runs an offense, in runs a defense, in runs special players. It was just, usually had 11 guys and you just kind of played till everyone got tired and you bring in more guys. But football's changed a great deal. It really has. Much faster game than when I was out there.
In spite of his many contributions to different phases of the game, Whitehead was best known for his play as a pass defender. In 1959, Whitehead and the other members of the Seminoles defensive secondary had one of the best days in FSU history by tallying 7 interceptions against Virginia Tech. Of those 7 picks, Whitehead was responsible for 3, helping to preserve a hard-fought 7-6 victory in Blacksburg. 1 year later, his contributions were recognized when Whitehead was selected as the Seminoles' most valuable player for 1960.
That was quite a highlight. I was very thankful, very glad that I had been the most valuable player of that football team my senior year. It was quite a honor for me to be voted MVP by your teammates, because those are the guys who know you best. It's not the crowd or some sports writers, etc. Nothing's wrong with that, but when your teammates vote you MVP, that's special. Really special, and I was quite honored, and I don't know that I deserved it, because there were some good ball players on our football team at the time, but I was very thankful.
1960 also marked the beginning of the Bill Peterson era at FSU. Under Peterson, FSU's program would make great strides, as Peterson took the Seminoles to consecutive bowl games for the first time in school history. One player who Peterson relied on was Walt Sumner. A fine athlete with speed to burn, the Florida State Brain Trust decided to try Sumner in the secondary. But no matter where the coaching staff decided to play him, who could have argued that Sumner would go on to great things as a Seminole? After all, he was recruited by then FSU assistant coach Bobby Bowden.
I arrived real early on in terms of being a quarterback, and it didn't take him long to move me to defensive back. But it really worked out well in the long run, because that was my forte, playing defensive back in college.
FSU secondary during the mid-60s was affectionately known as the Rat Pack, and Sumner would become their leader. As a sophomore, Sumner led the Seminoles with 4 interceptions. His interception in the end zone against Wake Forest in FSU's annual homecoming game helped preserve a 28-0 shutout. But for all of his accomplishments as a defensive back, Walt Sumner will always be remembered for one play in particular on special teams. In 1967, Florida State traveled to Birmingham to take on Bear Bryant and the Alabama Crimson Tide. The Seminoles entered the contest as a 3-touchdown underdog. But FSU would strike quickly to take an early 7-0 advantage. And just minutes later, Sumner took center stage, much to the chagrin of Bear Bryant.
Here's the snap. Davis takes it. He gets his kick away through Sumner's side at about the 24-yard line. He moves it out to the 30, gets the block to the 40, to the 50, to the 40, to the 30, to the 25, to the 15, to the 10, to the 5. He has taken that football 76 yards against the Crimson Tide.
What in the hell is happening over there? Get back out there. We don't know, and nobody on the phone, or you don't. What in the hell is going on?
Well, it was a return like any other in terms of we had a wall set up to one side or the other, and it just so happened that everything clicked. I mean, it's one of those plays where the ball's punted, you receive the ball, and as you turn, everybody's chopping someone down as you get to them. I mean, right as I get to the corner, I remember somebody just took somebody out. The fact there was nobody there, you just run into daylight.
Sumner's 75-yard punt return left Coach Bryant and the Alabama faithful in a state of disbelief. Bryant's reaction, an FSU stunning 37-37 tie, gained national attention when ABC used clips from the game in an hour-long documentary about the legendary Alabama coach.
Here's a man that you've always heard walked on water. And from that standpoint, and the program at Alabama, I mean, it was not just a program that was there for 1 year. It was a program that had been there for years and years. And we were striving to get to that point in time that they were at. And for him to say, you know, what the hell's going on out there was really neat and gave me, again, some attention that maybe I wouldn't have been deserving of otherwise, but it was neat. And I appreciated him saying it, even though I know it was detrimental to on his side of the field.
Like Whitehead before him, Sumner was a two-sport star and spent the following spring in center field for the Seminoles' nationally ranked baseball team. But it was on the football field where Sumner left a lasting impression. Although many Seminoles have achieved great things, perhaps no one player's arrival has had a greater impact on Florida State's program than James Thomas's. Known as JT, Thomas was the first African-American to see varsity action for Florida State. But despite any pressure that may have surrounded him due to the fact that he was the first African-American to play for the Seminoles, Thomas remained focused on football.
When you're young, you think about yourself succeeding, and you don't look at yourself as a pioneer. But I knew it was an opportunity, and I knew that if I succeeded, obviously, it would be an opportunity that my father or my grandfather didn't have. So I didn't think in terms of, I guess, the future benefits of it. But personally, I saw the opportunity and the benefits, you know, for myself.
Thomas wasted little time in proving himself on the gridiron. In the first game of the 1970 season, FSU was clinging to a two-point lead when Louisville lined up for a game-winning field goal. Thomas sprinted in off the corner and blocked the kick, and it appeared FSU had won the game.
It was only a few seconds left in the game, and we call, I think it was field goal block left, and I thought I'd saved the day on the initial block. And everyone was jumping all around, you know, we won the game, but what happened, I was offside. So you can imagine, the pressure came on. You know, they advanced the ball 5 yards for me being offside, a penalty. And you can imagine at that time how I felt in Bill Campbell Stadium. You know, we got in the hole, and I think we said a prayer at that time, and we called field goal block left again. And I blocked it again.
Thomas blocked the field goal attempt. This time, there were no flags, and FSU won 9-7. Later that same season, Thomas showed that he was a pretty good pass defender, returning an interception for a touchdown against in-state rival Miami. 3 weeks later, JT intercepted Kansas State's Lynn Dickey three times in a 33-7 Florida State victory. Thomas finished his sophomore season as the Tribe's top interceptor with six.
And Lynn Dickey at that time was one of, you know, the top major quarterbacks. So it was, you know, as a defensive back, anytime you get an interception, that's like, you know, going to heaven. And that game had three. Yeah, that was probably one of my greatest moments, I guess, in my college football career.
1970 would also prove to be Bill Peterson's last season as head coach of the Seminoles. The popular head coach had helped bring FSU out of obscurity and into the national spotlight. Following Peterson's departure, though, FSU endured some tough years, including a disappointing record of 3-8 in 1975. But in 1976, former assistant coach Bobby Bowden returned to Tallahassee to take over a program still searching for an identity. Bowden would also inherit a great cornerback by the name of Bobby Jackson. Bo Jack and the Seminoles quickly picked up Coach Bowden's system, and Florida State finished a respectable 5-6, a significant improvement over the 1975 finish. Jackson's three interceptions in 1976 ran his career total to 10.
Well, they did have to make a new transition, a new coaching staff, new techniques, and we came in and got pretty tough on them. You know, we were going to try to really discipline them, but they did a great job adjusting.
With Bowden pointing the way, the Noles surpassed nearly everyone's expectations in his second season as head coach. Under the tutelage of Jack Stanton, the defense held strong, and Jackson was a big reason why. Against Cincinnati, Jackson was a one-man wrecking crew. Not only did he return a Bearcat punt 54 yards, but he also intercepted a pass, helping FSU to its first shutout in 5 years.
Bobby Jackson was one of the best defensive backs we've had at Florida State. Played a lot of pro football, and which shows how successful he was. And he was probably the leader of our defensive team. First year, he struggled a little bit my first year. Second year, he became a pro.
Even though Bobby Bowden was just beginning to lay the foundation to build FSU into a football power, FSU's defensive backs had started their own tradition. Bobby Jackson would go on to play for the New York Jets. Bud Whitehead would enjoy a successful career with the San Diego Chargers. Walt Sumner played 6 seasons with the Cleveland Browns. But most notably, the Pittsburgh Steelers made James Thomas the first FSU defensive back ever to be taken in the first round of the NFL draft in 1973. Thomas would play in Pittsburgh for 9 seasons and was a starter for the Pittsburgh Super Bowl championship teams of the 1970s. But in each case, the road to success for these early greats in the defensive secondary can be traced back to their playing days with the Seminoles. Few players in college football have ever gotten the chance to realize their dreams. For a chubby 6-foot-tall walk-on, the odds were even more unlikely. But for a hard-working steel-casted kid from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, tenacity and perseverance would lead to great things on the football field. Before arriving at Florida State, Monk Bonasort was playing tight end in a sandlot league. Upon his arrival in Tallahassee, Bobby Bowden's coaching staff made a decision that would ultimately change the course of Bonasort's football career.
When I left high school, I received no scholarship offers. I played a year of sandlot ball up north in Pittsburgh, which was a big league. I mean, it was a lot of fun. A lot of ex-college players or players out of high school that didn't have an opportunity to play. And I had a coach who played Canadian football that knew Jack Stanton, or knew of Jack Stanton, Jack being from Pittsburgh, and tried to help an old Pittsburgh boy out. So he contacted Jack. Jack said, come on down. I remember getting in our car, driving down in the middle of March, paid our own way, got myself an apartment, paid my way through school, just on a whim.
We were going to try him as a defensive back, but he came, you know, a little overweight. And so we had to get him down. We had to get him down and lose about 30 pounds or so. And he did it. He got down. He went down all the way to exactly where we asked him to be. And that's the kind of person he was.
The decision to try Bonasort in the secondary soon paid off. During spring practice in 1977, Monk's determination made both teammates and coaches stand up and notice. He returned an interception 98 yards for a touchdown.
We were playing goal line defense, and the ball popped in the air, and I caught it, and I ran. And I remember getting to about the 10-yard line, and I kind of stopped and slowed down because I was really out of breath and out of shape. And the defensive back coach, Jack Stanton, yelling, cross the goal line, get over the goal. And I don't think I could practice after that. I was so tired.
Teamed up in a secondary, which also featured Bobby Jackson and Bobby Butler, the Tribe's defensive unit helped turn a 5-6 record from the 1977 season into a 10-2 mark in 1978. The Seminoles not only finished the season ranked 14th by the Associated Press, but they also gave FSU its first bowl victory in 12 years, crushing Texas Tech 40-17. In his sophomore year of 1978, Bonasort began to establish himself as a key member of the Seminole defense. Based on the success of his freshman season, Bonasort had earned a full scholarship. But that wasn't the only reason that 1978 was a special year for Monk. Florida State's 7th game that season was against the team from Bonasort's old stomping grounds, the University of Pittsburgh. In an inspired effort in front of dozens of family and friends, Bonasort and the Seminole defense held tough against Johnny Major's Panthers.
Playing back home, I had over 50 to 60 family and fans come. I had probably one of the best games that I played, at least to date, and probably pretty much through my career. We lost, but just to come home and be in my neighborhood, because I live about 2 miles from the University of Pittsburgh, was just an outstanding feeling.
Although they dropped the game by a heartbreaking final of 7-3, Bonasort shined, finishing the day with 17 tackles and 2 caused fumbles. FSU would close out the 78 season by winning their last 3 games, including a 38-21 victory over interstate rival Florida. Throughout his playing days as a Seminole, Bonasort was a threat to those who challenged the Seminole secondary. The former walk-on had become one of the leaders of the Seminole defense. What made his improbable rise to excellence so remarkable was the fact that few considered him to be a great athlete. What he may have lacked in physical ability, Monk made up for with intelligence and work ethic.
He studied film more than any other player I've ever had. And he'd be talking to all the other defensive players and telling them what to look for. And he'd be coming to me every day and asking me about, you know, these questions on what. And it was not luck. He worked at it. He knew the opponent as good as any player I've ever been around.
All of that studying paid off during his junior year of 1979, when he finished the season as the 4th leading interceptor in the nation with 8, tying an FSU single season record. His play helped the Seminoles to their first undefeated regular season. Although 1980 was not his best year statistically, Monk and the Seminoles found themselves ranked among the nation's top teams for a 2nd straight season. An October 11th showdown with the Pittsburgh Panthers gave Bonasort and the Seminoles an opportunity for revenge. With one of college football's most talented teams in town for homecoming, the Seminoles responded with a 36-22 win over the previously undefeated Panthers. A Seminole victory, along with a Bonasort interception, was a fitting way for Monk's final game against his hometown foes.
I think Monk's greatest game, and probably the one he enjoyed the most, was the game against Pittsburgh in 1980. Pittsburgh was the number 2 football team in the nation, and I'll be honest with you, it's the best football team I've ever lined up in 45 years against, was that Pittsburgh team of 1980. Monk, that was his hometown, and they were heavy favorites over us. Dan Marino at quarterback, Hugh Green at defensive end, Randy Jackson at the other defensive end. 17 boys that played in the pros, went to the pros. Monk had a great day and provided great leadership during that game and allowed us to upset that Pitt team.
By the end of his career, Bonasort had helped lead Florida State to national prominence. His 15 career interceptions broke the mark previously held by Lee Corso, a record which had stood for over 20 years. Monk Bonasort, a no-name kid whose gritty determination not only earned him a spot in the Florida State University Hall of Fame, but also on the list as one of FSU's greatest defensive backs. Monk Bonasort was not the only freshman to arrive in the fall of 1977 and go on to star in the FSU secondary. Bobby Butler, lightning-fast cornerback from Delray Beach, teamed up with Bonasort to give the Seminoles one of the most dominating defensive backfield tandems in all of college football. During their 4 years patrolling the secondary, Bonasort and Butler would combine for 26 interceptions. In 1980, they helped the Seminole defense hold opponents to a Florida State record low 8 touchdowns. Without a doubt, one of the major reasons that the 1980 defense was so successful was due to the outstanding play of Bobby Butler. But as good as Butler's career at FSU would end up, it didn't exactly get off to a picture-perfect start. In the inaugural game of his freshman season against Southern Mississippi, Butler received the nickname of Sweets. The circumstances surrounding his receiving this nickname, though, weren't exactly sweet.
Got a lot of playing time in the first game. Me and Bobby Jackson, I played half the game, he played half the game. But I was running to the ball on a play and didn't see an offensive lineman, and he just pinned me right in my ear hole from the blind side and knocked me out. I mean, I was unconscious. And my old high school coach, who was a graduate assistant here at the time, Steve Harton, made the statement, "Get Bobby, little sweet butt, off the field." So they started calling me Sweets.
Despite his early misadventure, Butler would go on to establish himself as a major contributor for the Seminoles. As the fastest member of the team, Butler used a combination of speed and aggressiveness to shine in both the secondary and on special teams.
Bobby wanted to be a punt returner, and he would have been a very good punt returner. But at the time, we were blocking punts. Our main thing on the punt was the block. We probably went after about 95% of the punts that we defended against, and I could just see him much better. I mean, helping the team a lot more than in blocking punts than I can, you know, in returning, which he'd have been a great one, I think.
Homecoming 1977 brought North Texas State to Doak Campbell Stadium. For Butler, it was an opportunity to show what he could do. Ivory Joe Hunter's recovery of Butler's block punt for a touchdown broke the game wide open as the Seminoles would go on to win 35-14. Throughout his career at FSU, his knack for blocking kicks was one of Butler's trademarks. Against Louisville in 1979, Butler not only blocked a Cardinal field goal attempt, but he also recovered a block punt for a touchdown. But Bobby was also flawless in coverage, finishing second to Bonasort in 1979 with 6 interceptions. FSU finished the 79 season undefeated at 11-0, poised for a matchup with national power Oklahoma in the Orange Bowl.
See, Florida State at the time, even though we had great ball clubs, we didn't have a tradition that we have today, you know. That was the first big-time game that we played. I mean, we were 11-0 regular season, no question. And, you know, for anybody to go undefeated, I don't care who you're playing, it's tough. But that was the first experience of the big time. You know, Orange Bowl, national attention, Heisman Trophy winner, Billy Sims on the other side. Yeah, I think we were in somewhat of awe in that game.
For the Seminoles, their first experience of college football's big time may have been too much for a program still emerging on the national scene. But for Butler, it was one of his finest performances. The junior cornerback blocked an Oklahoma punt, giving him 5 career blocks in just 3 years. Throughout his career, Butler was always being presented with a different challenge, usually drawing the opponent's top receiver in coverage. Whether it was Mississippi State's Marty McDowell or the Gators' Chris Collinsworth, Butler's task was never easy. But they were challenges that Butler accepted. And in the heat of battle, it was the speedy Butler who almost always came out on top. Butler's play exemplified the spirit of what Bobby Bowden's coaching staff was trying to establish at Florida State. Although soft-spoken, when Butler had something to say, his teammates listened.
He had such leadership because everybody liked him. The players liked him, the coaches liked him, and he led by example, which is the best way to lead. And I think that when he did say anything, everybody listened. He was a very good leader.
Butler would go on to be selected in the first round of the 1981 draft by the Atlanta Falcons. He became a fixture in the Falcons secondary until his retirement in 1992. A gifted athlete, a tremendous leader, and worthy of being called one of FSU's best ever. Bobby Butler's story is one of success, both in college and in the pros. But at times, it's also been a case of mistaken identity. A few years after Bobby's departure to the NFL, another Butler would arrive in Tallahassee. Bobby and Leroy Butler aren't related at all. But despite their careers being separated by some 6 years, many Seminole fans just can't seem to keep them straight. And there are a lot of reasons to remember Leroy Butler's career at FSU. But during his childhood, few could have imagined that Butler would ever go on to greatness on the football field. A congenital deformity left Butler severely pigeon-toed, forcing him to spend 3 years in knee braces. Butler was forced to sit out his freshman year at FSU under Proposition 48. After gaining solid academic status as a freshman, Butler was finally able to get back to playing football.
As one of the fastest players on the team, Butler spent time at safety, cornerback, and on special teams. But because he split playing time at free safety with Dedrick Dodge, Butler remained in relative obscurity. But all that would change on September 17th, 1988. With time running out, the 10th-ranked Seminoles found themselves deadlocked with the number 3 Clemson Tigers. Facing fourth down at his own 21, Bobby Bowden would make a decision that would not only change the course of the 1988 season, but also introduce the college football world to Leroy Butler.
And here's the short handoff, and the little handoff to the upback. Leroy Butler's got a long way to go to the 40. Leroy Butler to the 50. Leroy Butler to the 40, to the 30. Leroy Butler to the 20. Leroy to the 10. Leroy Butler knocked out of bounds at the 4-yard line. What a play by the Seminoles. Some razzle-dazzle.
The punt Ruski not only cemented Butler in Seminole legend, but it also provided a launch pad for a stellar career at FSU.
I think Leroy went 78 yards on the play. We did not expect that. We was hoping it would hammer out a first down and give us some momentum, you know, but we decided to go ahead and go with it. We called it. All the coaches ran, hid under the bench somewhere where nobody knew where they were, and it worked better than we drew it up.
Teamed up in a secondary, which also featured Deion Sanders, Butler made great strides as a junior, registering 59 tackles and 2 interceptions, including a 26-yard INT return, which broke open a close game with Michigan State.
And McAllister wants to run. He's going to be hit as he got the ball away. It's picked off by Butler. Butler to the 15, to the 10, to the 5. He's in for the touchdown. Florida State with an interception by Leroy Butler.
Butler also displayed an ability to play with pain. After suffering a broken knuckle against Louisiana Tech, Butler played the last 5 games of the 88 season with a cast on his hand.
Leroy Butler with a cast on his hand and all leaps into the air to pick it off.
With the departure of All-American cornerback Deion Sanders to the NFL, the responsibility of being the big play guy in the FSU secondary fell on Butler's shoulders. The coaching staff moved the senior safety to cornerback, hoping for big results as the 89 season kicked off. However, following back-to-back losses to Southern Miss and Clemson, there was little reason for fanfare. Following an 0-2 start, Florida State ran the table, finishing the 1989 season with a record of 10-2. And it was during that run of 10 straight wins that Leroy Butler established himself as the next in the line of great Seminole defensive backs. Butler finished the 1989 season with 7 interceptions and was voted a consensus All-American at cornerback. A second-round draft choice of Green Bay in 1990, Butler has emerged as one of the premier safeties in the NFL and was a major factor in the Packers' Super Bowl 31 victory over New England. Leroy Butler, a person who proved that determination can triumph over adversity. And a player who will forever be remembered as one of Florida State's finest defensive backs. To say that Terrell Buckley dominated a cornerback during his career at Florida State might be an understatement. Between 1989 and 1991, T-Buck's signature was not only smothering opposing receivers, but he also gave new meaning to the term big play. An amazing natural athlete, Terrell, among his many other accomplishments, also played baseball for Florida State. What makes his accomplishments on the football field so amazing was the fact that he was barely 5'9". But whether it was on defense or special teams, Buckley's awesome athletic ability made up for the fact that he was almost always at a height disadvantage when going up against some of the nation's top receivers. On October 7, 1989, the kid from Pascagoula, Mississippi, burst onto the college football scene. On that day, the Seminoles traveled to the Carrier Dome to take on the Syracuse Orange Men. Buckley, as he would time and time again during his career, grabbed the spotlight, employing a bit of trickery to help the Seminoles thrash the Orange Men.
Buckley called for the fair catch. No, he did not. He feigned everybody. There he goes. Goodbye. What a fake by Buckley.
You know, I caught the ball And I just stood there just to see what type of reaction I was going to get. And everybody stopped. I mean, actually, one of the guys was beside me just standing there. And then the lane just opened up and I took off, and I think Corey Freeman made a nice block for me that really opened it up, and it was green. Just the turf was in front of me.
Oh, that was amazing. That's where he got the nickname, the Fula, from Pascagoula, because he fooled them. Yeah, he faked, they punted to him, and he just took the ball and stood there, you know. So they came down and just stopped. Then all of a sudden, he took off and ran for a touchdown. And nobody told him to. I like stuff like that. It was clever, and I think people enjoyed it.
The Fooler from Pascagoula, as it became known, was part of a three-return, 88-yard performance by Buckley. He would equal that amount the very same year against Clemson. Terrell also went on to haul in three interceptions during his freshman season of 1989, including two against Memphis State. As his sophomore season kicked off, Terrell wasted little time getting back into the swing of things. In their 1990 opener, the Seminoles found themselves in a dogfight against the East Carolina Pirates. With FSU leading 17-10, Buckley started to get things going midway through the second quarter. But a long East Carolina scoring drive on the ensuing possession cut the Seminole lead to 24-17 as the first half ended. Quarterback Jeff Blake moved the Pirates into FSU territory to start the second half. But just when it looked as if ECU was going to deadlock the score at 24 apiece, Buckley came up with another big play. For the Seminoles, the first interception set up a key touchdown as FSU would go on to win 45-24. And for Buckley, his first interception of the year set the tone for a stellar sophomore year.
Buckley, he could go down to the 30, to the 40. He's dancing to the 50, to the 30-yard line. Terrell Buckley will score his third touchdown of the season.
Buckley finished the 1990 season with a bang, returning a punt against Penn State 39 yards, which helped set up FSU's first touchdown of the game in a 24-17 defeat of Joe Paterno's Nittany Lions. For the season, Buckley led the Seminoles in interceptions with six, ranking him 14th in the nation, averaging 36.5 yards per interception return for an FSU single season record 219 yards. He was also selected as a second team All-American in just his second season. But as good as his sophomore campaign was, no one could have imagined the extent to which Buckley would dominate the 1991 season. Every week, Terrell faced the nation's best receivers, and every week, it was Buckley who stole the show. Never was his ability to rise to the challenge better illustrated than when the Seminoles traveled to Ann Arbor in a game that pitted them against the number three ranked Michigan Wolverines. Michigan's Desmond Howard was the receiver that everyone was talking about, and he would eventually go on to win the 1991 Heisman Trophy.
You know, a couple of my teammates even were talking about, hey, oof, that Desmond Howard is making catches left and right, diving between his legs, and it's going to be a real challenge for you, T-Buck. And they knew any type of challenge, that was just going to fire me up even more.
But on that afternoon, it was Buckley, not Howard, who captured the attention of the college football world.
Gerback looks to his right, fires the pass. It's picked off, intercepted by Terrell Buckley to the 20, to the 10. Buckley, touchdown, Florida State.
Buckley's 40-yard interception return to open the game gave the Seminoles a lead they would never relinquish.
Coach Andrews always taught us, the first thing you do as a corner is read the three step. And from that, you can make plays. And so I was just trying to be fundamentally sound and given the opportunity, which I knew I was going to lock covering Desmond. I was basically assigned to him all day. And I made the first play. That was a great game, a great battle, and I always remember that game.
We were playing at the University of Michigan there with about 105,000 people there, national television, armed service television all over the world. And they take the opening drive and make a couple of first downs also, and they throw that ball in the flat. And Buck, he reads that thing, boy, and breaks on it, gets it, runs for a touchdown. It set the tone for the game, there's no doubt about it.
While he added another interception and a 31-yard punt return on that same afternoon, it was his first quarter touchdown return that set the tone as FSU handed Michigan their worst home defeats of the 20th century. Buckley would finish 1991 with a school record 12 interceptions. In just three seasons, he had set the NCAA record for yards on interception returns with 501. His 21 career interceptions was a new Florida State record, blowing away the previous mark of 15 held by Monk Bonasort. Terrell's record-setting 1991 season came to a fitting conclusion when he was selected as the 1991 Jim Thorpe Award recipient, going to the nation's most outstanding defensive back.
That was very special, and that's one of the moments that you'll never forget. It's like getting married, having your first child. Very special, and I relive that moment a lot.
Buckley, now a starter with the Miami Dolphins, would go on to be selected with the fifth overall pick in the 1992 NFL Draft by the Green Bay Packers. But despite his exploits in the pros, Buckley will always be remembered as one of the greatest cornerbacks ever to play at Florida State. His knack for big plays almost made everyone forget about another cornerback that had played for the Seminoles just a few years earlier. Almost. No player in Florida State history has ever combined excitement, athletic ability, and showmanship better than number two, Deion Sanders. His playmaking ability not only left a lasting impression on the Seminole faithful, but it also set the standard by which defensive backs at Florida State will be measured for decades to come.
Well, there's no doubt about it. Deion, in my opinion, probably the best corner I ever been on a college football field. From the moment he came into our camp, it was very obvious there's something special about this guy. This guy is quick as a cat and is an instinctive football player and can fly.
Not only was Deion a superb cover man, but during his career as a Seminole, Sanders was, without question, the most dangerous punt returner in college football.
A lot of noise. Good center snap when the freshman punter gets it away. It's a line drive thing. Backpedaling is Sanders. Boy, he got a long leg into it. Sanders fields at the 11. 15 it is. Looks for a block. He gets the block he needs. Makes his cut upfield. Sanders to the 45. Sanders to the 50. Sanders still on his feet to the 40-yard line. What a return by Deion Sanders.
Shortly after his arrival in 1985, people soon realized that when Deion made plays, he made them bigger, better and faster than any before him or after him. In his first year as a Seminole, Sanders began his journey into legend when he intercepted a pass against Tulsa and returned it 100 yards, setting a new FSU school record. Following his first football season, it was clear that Sanders was special. During the 1986 baseball season, Deion stole 28 bases while playing all three outfield positions as FSU advanced to the College World Series. But being a two-sport star just wasn't enough for primetime. During the spring of 1986, Sanders could also be found running on FSU's 400-meter relay team. But it was on the football field where Deion clearly was head and shoulders above the competition. In only his sophomore year, Sanders was named defensive MVP for the Seminoles.
Well, he got on that field now. He was a great leader. He taught football. He played the best he could play, and all of his teammates admired him. He was a great practice player. I seen him go out there when he couldn't hardly walk in practice. A lot of these stars don't want to do that, but he did.
In just his second season of college football, Sanders was a finalist for the Jim Thorpe Award,
and was selected to four All-America teams. But for Dion, it was just the beginning. During his career, Dion went up against the best receivers in the land, like Michigan State's Andre Rison. FSU played the Spartans during consecutive seasons of 1987 and 88. Not only did Dion cover Rison, he shut the Spartans All-American down as FSU outscored Michigan State 61-10 in those two games.
He was a football player. If you were on offense, you better know where he was. I thought his greatest series, we played Michigan State. They had a great receiver in Rison who played, you know, with the pro ball did such so great. And I think the years that Dion had the defense, which was 2 years, I think Dion caught more passes than Rison did. I think he intercepted more than he caught. And I'll tell you something about him.
But receivers weren't the only ones who feared Sanders. Quarterbacks knew that throwing against primetime was like playing Russian roulette. One signal caller who was happy to see Dion graduate was Southern Miss's Brett Favre.
Favre rolling and throwing under pressure, and it's intercepted. Dion, he may score right away. It is Sanders for the touchdown.
Although Leroy Butler would steal the spotlight a week later against Clemson with the punt Ruski, it was Sanders who got the momentum back in FSU's favor.
He wants it, and now it'll be Dion Sanders from the 24. In the middle, twists his way, finds an alley. Now it's just the punter, he'll outrun it. It's going to be a touchdown, Florida State, Dion Sanders.
Dion's punt return for a touchdown got Florida State back in the game as FSU would go on to upset the third-ranked Tigers 24-21. 1988 would also mark the second straight year that the Seminoles finished in the top five. But before FSU could solidify the number three overall ranking, they had to face the SEC champion Auburn Tigers in the 55th annual Sugar Bowl. In a hard-fought defensive game, FSU found itself leading 13-7 with less than a minute to play. Auburn quarterback Reggie Slack converted on fourth down three times on the Tigers' final drive to set up a 3rd-and-10 from the FSU 22-yard line. But with just seconds remaining, Dion Sanders found the perfect way to end his illustrious career as a Seminole. Sanders' achievements were recognized when he became the first Seminole defensive back ever to receive the Jim Thorpe Award in 1988. His 14 career interceptions rank him third all-time in the FSU record books. Sanders was also a consensus All-American in 1987 and 1988. A first-round pick of the Atlanta Falcons in the 1989 draft, Sanders has dazzled both the NFL and Major League Baseball with his awesome athletic ability, winning Super Bowls with both the 49ers and the Cowboys. In 1995, Sanders returned to Doug Campbell Stadium to have his jersey retired.
Ladies and gentlemen, direct your attention to the north end zone and join us in welcoming back Prime Time!
With over 80,000 in attendance, the ceremony signified that number two will never again be worn by any Seminole player. Sanders is also one of only four Seminole greats to have his locker sealed to honor his two-time All-American status. Dion Sanders, a player of uncanny ability, a player for the ages, and Florida State's greatest defensive back.